prayer. There's a lengthy prayer of Ezra in the book of Ezra, chapter 9. And if you read the prayer by yourself, you will see that his recognition of the seriousness of Israel's sin, as well as his remembrance of God's grace, were very, very deep. His recognition of sin and his remembrance of God's grace. And so in Ezra chapter 9, we read the following words in his prayer. And so let me read that to you as we begin today, although this might be slightly long, well, not really long, just a few verses, but by the let me begin with this prayer that Ezra offered to God back in chapter 9. He said, "I am too ashamed and disgraced, my Lord, to lift up my face to you, because our sins are higher than our heads, and our guilt has reached to the heavens. From the days of our ancestors until now, our guilt has been great. Because of our sins, we and our kings and our priests have been subjected to the sword and captivity, to pillage and humiliation at the hand of foreign kings, as it is today. But now, for a brief moment, the Lord our God has been gracious in leaving us a remnant and giving us a firm place in his sanctuary. So our God gives light to our eyes and a little relief in our bondage. Though we are slaves, our God has not forsaken us in our bondage. He has shown us kindness in the sight of the kings of Persia. He has granted us new life to rebuild the house of God and repair its ruins. And he has given us a wall of protection in Judah and Jerusalem." This is a beautiful prayer, by the way, and I would encourage you to go back to it and read it once again if you'd like to. But let me just raise another question here. How about the prayer of Nehemiah? Did he also show depth in his recognition of the seriousness of Israel's sin and also of the depth and amazingness of God's sovereign grace? Well, the answer is, of course, yes, because we also see Nehemiah's deep prayer in chapter 1, where he said, among many other words, and let me read a few verses once again. He said, "Lord, the God of heaven, the great and awesome God, who keeps his covenant of love with those who love him and keep his commandments, let your ear be attentive and your eyes open to hear the prayer your servant is praying before you day and night for your servants, the people of Israel. I confess the sins we Israelites, including myself and my father's family, have committed against you. We have acted very wickedly toward you. We have not obeyed the commands, decrees, and laws you gave your servant Moses." So, as we read this prayer here in chapter 9, which is one of the longest prayers that you see in the Bible, which, by the way, is the prayer presented and offered by the Jews, ordinary people themselves. And as we read this prayer in chapter 9, let's not forget that the prayer coming from the mouth of these Jews in Jerusalem was similar to the prayers of their own leaders, that is, Ezra and Nehemiah. This prayer from the ordinary people and the prayers of their leaders, Ezra and Nehemiah, had something in common and shared something typical in altogether. And that unique or common thing is something that I want to attend to together as we read this chapter this morning. There are some common and typical themes and patterns of prayer that we see throughout Ezra and Nehemiah. And as we do that, I'd like to mention just two things. As we try to learn to pray like these people, and also as we try to see the world and our God like them. But before I present you with those two points that we have to see, I think, in the prayer, let me first say a few things about the context in which this prayer was being offered. And the first three verses give us important information. And we read, "On the 24th day of the same month, the Israelites gathered together, fasting and wearing sackcloth and putting dust on their heads. Those of Israelite descendant had separated themselves from all foreigners. They stood in their places and confessed their sins and the sins of their ancestors. They stood where they were and read from the book of the law of the Lord their God for a quarter of the day, and spent another quarter in confession and in worshiping the Lord their God. So briefly speaking, what's happening here is an extension and continuation of what was already happening before in the earlier part of the month. And if you recall from chapter 8, the Jews were asking Ezra to read from the book of Moses, and they were willing to learn from that book God's holy will concerning a righteous life, and they wanted to understand God from the word preached and from the word read. They devoted themselves to God's word from daybreak till noon as a gathered assembly. And it wasn't just a day or two, right, that they read God's word, but it was pretty much the whole season that they read and learned the word. They devoted themselves to the stories and precepts and promises recorded in the first five books of the Bible. And as they did that, they could reflect on God's holy will thoroughly. They could reflect on Israel's sin more thoroughly, and they could think about their own future more thoroughly in the light of the word written and taught. And so if we come to verse 1 here in chapter 9, we see that the background is basically the same month, right? And what this tells us is that the prayer from these ordinary Jews was a response to the word they were meditating upon and reflecting upon all these past weeks. They read stories about Adam, Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, and many other figures and people associated with God's saving grace. And they learned from the books of Moses, book of Exodus onwards to the end of Deuteronomy, the very precepts and laws that God wanted them to observe and follow. They read the law and learned God's will. And not only that, they paid attention to the countless promises of God that were recorded in the first five books of Moses, and they used their minds and hearts to search the promises of God, the will of God, as they paid attention to those records. And so let's, in the light of that, you know, general background or context, let's now then move to the two things that I mentioned earlier. And the first common thing in the prayers of the Jews, including Ezra and Nehemiah, the first thing I want to say today, and that I want you to notice, is that the people of God always remember God's work in detail. The people of God always remember God's work in detail. And I'll try to be a bit exact or perhaps even pedantic this morning, because I really want to help you see the details in the prayer here. And so let's slowly move from verse 6 and look at how the Jews there described and acknowledged the work of God in detail. So if we start from verse 6, we find these verbs that are important for us to notice. Verse 6, "You alone are the Lord. You made the heavens, even the highest heavens and all their starry hosts, the earth and all that is on it, the seas and all that is in them. You give life to everything, and the multitudes of heaven worship you." So this is what we might regard as the recognition of God's creative work, or remembering God as our creator. This kind of recognition was a common pattern in the way Israelites engaged in their spiritual worship and prayer, and it is still a very important duty in the way Christians ought to live out their lives before God. This is still important for us to imitate and practice, because recognizing God is the creator of everything and the giver of all life has always been the basis for understanding God's sovereignty, God's authority, and God's power. Recognizing God as the creator of everything and the giver of all life has always been the basis for understanding His sovereignty, His authority, and His power over all things. From the early days of Israel until now in the 21st century, God's faithful servants have always recognized God as their creator and maker. And without this belief in God as the only creator of the world, and without this confession of God as the creator and maker of our souls, we would not make sense of other works of God that we find recorded and revealed in the Bible. The doctrine of creation that teaches us about God as the creator of all things is the bedrock upon which other doctrines stand for their rationale. And this is the assumption upon which other teachings of the Bible are based. And this, of course, is the confession that God's people have always offered and presented in their gatherings before the presence of the Holy God. And so if you look at your life from that perspective, when have you had a chance to reflect on God as the creator and maker and governor of all things? When we had hot summer days, for example, I mean, it's getting really cold these days, but a few weeks back, we had really hot days, if you remember. When we had those beautiful but still hot days, have you ever thought about God as the wise maker of the sun, as the wise maker of the heat, air, trees, water, and of course, your body and soul? Or when you went to the beach and enjoyed the breeze and the ocean, have you praised God for making them and governing them as the powerful governor of all things? Or if you tend to be a bit analytic in the way you approach the world, have you tried to move from analyzing that which you analyzed, you know, whether it's plants or animals or machines or language or even human behavior? Have you moved from that to the praise of God's wisdom and power over the things that you were attending to? Have you really attended to the creative and governing work of God in recent times? And is this kind of confession a common pattern of your prayer? Is this a common pattern of your life and acknowledgement in the Lord Jesus Christ? Confessing God as our creator is the basic responsibility that we all share as Christians and as God's precious children. And that is the basic duty that we all share along with the old Israel, right? We have to see the work of our Father in this creation, even when all the other people out there are neglecting it, dismissing it, or even hiding it. Well, we Christians have to remember that we are the people whose eyes have been opened by the work of the Holy Spirit to see and discern God's governing and creative power behind all things. Just like the Jews here in this prayer, we should also recognize that glorious truth in our own prayer as well. And just like they praise God for his work of creation, we should also praise him for making the world and governing it according to his perfect power. So that's the first thing I want you to notice. But we're still continuing under the broad theme in terms of understanding God's work in detail. But let's now move to other verbs that we find here in verses 7 and 8. And let's now consider briefly the work of redemption on the part of God. Not just his work of creation, but also his work of redemption. And so we go to verse 7 and find, "You are the Lord God who chose Abram and brought him out of Ur of the Chaldeans and named it Abraham. You found his heart faithful to you, and you made a covenant with him to give to his descendants the land of the Canaanites, Hittites, Amorites, Perizzites, Jebusites, and Girgashites. You have kept your promise because you are righteous." And again, the Jews in Jerusalem learned from the Bible that God did not just create the world and left it right away, as if God was tired of dealing with creatures after he made them. But the people then believed, and rightly, that the creator of the world came to Abram and chose him and brought him out of his dwelling place and gave him a new name. That is Abraham, to mark him, to designate him as his special child. God chose Abraham, he brought him, and he named him. And after all these great acts of deliverance and redemption, God went a few more steps and he found Abram's heart faithful and made a covenant with him. God did not choose Abraham and change his name just to bless his own life, which in and of itself is still amazing and surprising. But God did make a covenant with him, not only to bless him, but also to bless all his descendants. God chose him and delivered him and named him and covenanted with him. And all these saving works of God set the paradigm for the ways in which our God deals with all sinners, including of us here in this place. And so if I ask you, in the light of this brief account here, have you tried to think of God's work of salvation in recent times? Perhaps you're struggling in relationships. Perhaps your work wasn't going well, or perhaps you're having serious illness or discomfort that really weakened you or troubled you. And in those situations, if you had them, and whatever struggle you may have had, have you tried to remember God's saving grace, His saving promise, and His comforting words that give you life, that give you strength? Have you thought about God's work of redemption for you and for His people in general? And have you tried to believe and trust His precious promises as you pray to God to help you? Have you attended to God's work of salvation? And so just like remembering God's work of creation is important in the Christian life, remembering His work of redemption is also crucial in the Christian life, because while we acknowledge God's authority and power and sovereignty by remembering Him as our Creator, we come to acknowledge His mercy, His grace, and love by remembering His work of redemption. We do not stop at praising God for His work of creation and governance, because our God is not just the God of nature. But we go further than that and praise Him for His work of redemption, because He is also the God of grace. The work of God is so diverse and wide that not one category would capture everything. And it is so intricate and sophisticated that one verb would not capture all the nuances and shades of His actions. We lack enough words to describe the work of God in the most precise way, and that's why we use lots and lots of different verbs to perceive and explain God's glorious works, whether it's, you know, the work of creation or the work of redemption. And so I'll read now the following verses until verse 15, and please do notice how the Jews back then attended to the work of God in detail. So I'll read from verse 9 until 15, and let's please pay attention to all the verbs that you see here in this passage or prayer. So verse 9, you saw the suffering of our ancestors in Egypt. You heard their cry at the Red Sea. You sent signs and wonders against Pharaoh, against all his officials and all the people of his land, for you knew how arrogantly the Egyptians treated them. You made a name for yourself which remains to this day. You divided the sea before them so that they passed through it on dry ground, but you hurled their pursuers into the depths like a stone into mighty waters. By day you led them with a pillar of cloud, and by night with a pillar of fire to give them light on the way they were to take. You came down on Mount Sinai and spoke to them from heaven. You gave them regulations and laws that are just and right, and decrees and commands that are good. You made known to them your holy Sabbath and gave them commands, decrees, and laws through your servant Moses. In their hunger, you gave them bread from heaven, and in their thirst, you brought them water from the rock. You told them to go in and take possession of the land you had sworn with uplifted hand to give them. And of course, I can continue all the way, but I'm just going to stop there as we reflect on this prayer. And so, one thing I want to say is, please pay attention to the work of God in detail. It will deepen your spiritual life. It will deepen your acknowledgement of God's grace and His power. Please remember His work of creation as well as His work of redemption. And if you do it regularly, continually, and more importantly, in the corporate setting like what we are in right now, if you continue this, this will deepen your prayers and it will strengthen your faith. And so we have the method of deepening our faith, and that is to attend to the work of God in detail and give praises to God for those amazing actions. And so that's the first point that I wanted to cover, that God's people remember God's work in detail. But the second point I want to mention, second common principle and pattern in these prayers, is that God's people always remember their sins in detail. The people of God not only remember God's work in detail, but they also remember their own sins in detail. So please listen to this from verse 16. They said, "But they," referring to our ancestors, "became arrogant and stiff-necked, and they did not obey your commands. They refused to listen and failed to remember the miracles that you performed among them. They became stiff-necked and in their rebellion appointed a leader in order to return to their slavery. But you're a forgiving God, gracious and compassionate, slow to anger and abounding in love. Therefore, you did not desert them, even when they cast for themselves an image of a calf and said, 'This is your God who brought you out of Egypt,' or when they committed awful blasphemies." So again, we find the details of the sins the ancestors of Israel had committed, and their sins are described here in terms of, you know, they were arrogant, they were stiff-necked. They did not obey God's laws, they refused to listen and failed to remember God's grace, and they committed awful blasphemies against the God who saved them. They basically rebelled against God who saved them, who protected them, who provided for them, and that was really the essence of their sin, according to Israel's own acknowledgement and admission. They rebelled against their covenant God and refused to listen to him. And if we jump to verse 26, we also learn that the ancestors of Israel turned their backs on God's law, and they killed God's prophets, and they did what was evil in God's holy sight. And verse 29, I think, gives us a good summary of their sinful works in response to the Savior. And so this is what we read in verse 25. "Stubbornly they turned their backs on you and became stiff-necked and refused to listen." And so in this prayer, we have detailed acknowledgments of God's amazing work as well as Israel's own rebellion. And these two things are the pillars that sustain the spiritual life of Israel. And these two things ought to be the two pillars that should sustain our Christian life as well. Recognizing our God as the Creator and also the redemption is the basis upon which all other confessions are based. And confessing God as our Savior and Redeemer is the basis upon which our salvation is dependent and the anchor by which we remain stable in this fleeting life. We have to acknowledge these two things, and we have to make confessions on those two things regularly as God's people. And so as we end today, I want to close with this simple exhortation, and that is, let's attend to God's grace and our sins in detail. Let that be the simple exhortation for today. Let's attend to God's grace and our sins in detail. Just like the Jews confessed their sins and praised God's work in detail, let us also confess our sins and God's grace in detail. And as we do that, let's remember that without our Lord Jesus Christ, we have no ultimate hope for forgiveness or acceptance for adoption, because without Jesus Christ, we have no access to God's saving grace. Without Jesus, we'll be lost, and without Jesus, we'll be judged, and only through and by Jesus Christ, together with his Holy Spirit, can we attend to all the details with open and attentive eyes, and we can give thanks to him by the work of the Holy Spirit. And so please let me end by reading the passage that I read from Ephesians chapter 1, or in fact, just a few verses from that. Because if we turn to Ephesians chapter 1 and look at Paul's praising of God there, we'll see an expansion of the vocabularies that Paul used to acknowledge God's amazing grace. So as we hear this prayer or praise from Ephesians chapter 1, please also notice the different verbs that you find and give praises to God accordingly. So let me end with this. The Apostle Paul said, "Praise be to the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who has blessed us in the heavenly realms with every spiritual blessing in Christ. For he chose us in him before the creation of the world to be holy and blameless in his sight. In love, he predestined us for adoption to sonship through Jesus Christ in accordance with his pleasure and will, to the praise of his glorious grace, which he has freely given us in the one he loves. In him we have redemption through his blood, the forgiveness of sins, in accordance with the riches of God's grace that he lavished on us. With all wisdom and understanding, he made known to us the mystery of his will according to his good pleasure, which he purposed in Christ to be put into effect when the times reach their fulfillment, to bring unity all things in heaven and on earth under Christ. Amen. Let's pray. Our gracious Father, we thank you that you have led us to this place of worship today and enabled us to attend to your word, specifically from Nehemiah chapter 9. And Father, we pray that as we spend the past hour or so reflecting on your grace recorded for us in the chapter, please help us attend to your work in detail, as well as to our own sins in detail, so that we can give you more praises. We can thank you even more for the various ways in which you served us, saved us, and sanctified us. And please help us acknowledge that we don't really deserve your grace, because our sins are great and they are higher than our heads. But by Jesus Christ and through his work, you have saved us and delivered us from the kingdom of darkness. And we thank you for your grace in delivering us and transferring us into your kingdom of heaven. So help us live the rest of the week giving you thanks and praises for your grace, and help us reflect on you even more as we attend to the things of the world and things that are going on in our hearts. Bless us, and we pray these things in Jesus' precious name. Amen.